Good morning. Welcome back. It's good to see all of your really happy faces this morning, and I'm not kidding. You look great. Our friend John Nonhoff suggested that I ask you, all of you, I'm opening the floor, what happened to the Tigers last night? 11 to 10. Well, that's closer than I thought it was going to be. Thank you for that. Thank you for that. Well, we're happy to have you here, as you know. And we're asking again to take out those cell phones and make sure they're silenced so we don't distract from the presentation today. And thank you for that. We're welcoming all those who are out there in Zoom, in the virtual classroom. And we're thanking David Blatt, our special course technician. Thank you, David, for supporting our hybrid modality. The other reminder, of course, is about membership. We're hoping that you'll all renew, aren't we? Yes.
Yeah. Yes. Yes.
Yes. So the renewing time is open now, and you can refer to the weekly HASP happenings, which includes a direct link to the renewal form, and be sure you select renewal. That's important, because we're going to be coming back with a lot more good things next year. We are welcoming back for a second session on Vietnam Retrospective today, our friend, Dr. Fred Johnson. He's been at Hope College as a professor for 23 years.
As of next month, yeah.
As of next month. I think we need to give him a hand.
Yeah. My sister keeps asking me why I haven't come back to the DC area. I said, because you're there.
But we're here, and that's good, right?
That's right. That's right.
Well, Fred Johnson has a bachelor's from Boise State in Maryland, born in Virginia, I think you said. Mm-hmm. Virginia. A master's and doctorates from Kent State. And you know a lot about him. You know that he's very interested in anything military. So we heard a lot about that last week when we had our first session about the Vietnam retrospective, but today is different. Today is going to be more peaceful. And I think there's going to be, the idea is to have peace, peace in Vietnam. So this will go back to times when Fred Johnson took college students to Vietnam, and that will be great. Any more testimony to come before the lodge? All right, we're going to introduce you and say thank you again for being here. We appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Good morning, scholars of HASP. It was so encouraging when I walked in, the sign said, HASP scholars. I said, yes, good. It's catching on. It's right. Last week was, of course, devoted to primarily the war. But I got to tell you that even when we take students to Vietnam now, the war is everywhere. Now, the complaint that I've heard from my scholars and from my colleagues in Vietnam, you know, they have the same observation about the war, the past, that we do over here. They said, our children don't even remember the war. They don't care about it. So they don't remember what we did to fight for their freedom. I went, yeah, that sounds kind of familiar. So there's much concern about preserving the conflict and the legacy of Vietnam's independence as anything else. I once saw this at the Marine Corps Reserve Center on the side of a sea ration box. And a lot of Vietnam veterans will remember this. For those who fight for it and almost die for it, freedom has a taste to it the protected will never know. That is absolutely correct. I don't know about you, but too often in my life, I've met people that say, I have this right, I have that right, I deserve this, I deserve that. They're like, why do you deserve that? How do you know you have that right? And if you do have that right, do you know why that right exists? Who gave it to you? Or you can afford to have that right? People think of democracy as this magical thing that burst into life one day, it just automatically maintains itself. It doesn't. Vietnam exists in that area, right down there in the South China Sea. If you look at where Vietnam is on the map, it's in a very crowded neighborhood of Vietnam, Cambodia, Laos, next door to China. China, throughout Vietnam's history, Vietnam's long history, China has invaded Vietnam many times and been repelled many times. The Vietnamese are kind of like the Afghans of Asia, very hard to conquer. They're just like, they're not having it. And then, of course, there's the Philippines, which, of course, is always dear to my heart. I spent half my childhood in the Philippines. But to the north of the Philippines is Japan. And then, of course, the Korean Peninsula. You all are very much well-read and well-tuned to current events. You've heard about the American soldier that's been captured by the North Koreans, right? He wandered into North Korea. I said to myself, how do you wander into North Korea? And then there's Indonesia and then Malaysia. I had the good fortune of being in Malaysia a few years ago, competing in the international, the World Championship of Public Speaking. Malaysia is a beautiful country. But in that same area, you find the Straits of Malacca. It's a very busy, some of the world's heaviest shipping lanes in that area. And then, of course, the South China Sea and Vietnam. Now, the last couple of presidential administrations have looked to shift Americans' focus more away from Europe. At least that's what they were doing at the time, prior to the invasion of Ukraine by Russia. But now we had to find a way of doing two things or doing two things at once again, which is looking at both Europe and Asia, because China is the big behemoth in that area. They're not going away anytime soon. Neither is Russia. So we had to be in both places. Now, 2018 was such a great year compared to what happened in 2019. In 2019, I took students to Vietnam. Dr. Van de Stoop and I took students to Vietnam in May. When I got back, I went to a global health conference in Panama, or rather in Ecuador, in June. Then that December in 2019, I went to the second part two of the global health conference, which is held in Hong Kong, about 500 miles from Wuhan, China, which is where the global pandemic broke out, so they said. After that, all bets were off as far as travel was concerned, even inside the United States. I just got to tell you that at those global health conferences in Ecuador and in Hong Kong, everything they said you're supposed to do to not do during a pandemic, we did. So it was the year of COVID-19. And as you know, it changed the world, to include how we're even doing this presentation this morning. As I mentioned to you all last week, in 2018, 2017, the idea of a hybrid presentation that would have involved all kinds of hygiene and mental gymnastics, well, now it's just another way we do things. So the question came up in 2022. The pandemic was starting to recede, and Vietnam has some real tight restrictions on travel. Had to jump through a few extra hoops. And the question was, do we do it anyway? Dr. Van de Stoop then informed me, he said, his daughter was graduating from medical school at Johns Hopkins. He said, well, should I go? I can probably make it there. Or maybe I got to send you ahead with the students. I said, go to your daughter's graduation. I said, Scott, this is how I ended up living with a dog. Go to your daughter's graduation. Okay. So do we do it anyway? I said, yes. The students are excited. They want to go. We've gone through the training, the teaching. Let's go anyway. So we got the overseas office to agree that our in-country contact could be our number two, because Hope Wisely has a policy that you should have two faculty taking the students overseas. Now, this was going to be a trip, of course, dedicated to history and culture. And because Vietnam was what it was to America, also the war. During the first 6 weeks of the spring semester, not the first 6 weeks, but every Monday evening in preparing for the students for the trip to Vietnam, because the average 18-year-old these days was even born on 9/11, which means that, as I mentioned to you all last week, talking to them about Vietnam, may as well be talking about the battle at Thermopylae. They don't know about the Cold War. They've heard about the Cold War, but I think we had to give them instruction of the Cold War, what that entire environment was like. Part of that involves mentioning to them what I found out in 2019 when Tuan, my number two in 2022, brought to me some documents about from an organization called the VAFA, the Vietnam America Friends Association, a short-lived organization that lasted the latter part of 1945 and just a few months into 1946. But it was the Vietnamese government officials' attempt to establish a relationship, an economic and I guess business and maybe even geostrategic or military alliance with the United States based on the cooperation between the two countries in fighting the Japanese during World War II. Now, it is amazing how fast things change. We go from being an ally to the possibility of building bridges to friendship, just blowing them all up because of a thing called the Cold War. So we teach the students that the Cold War was a very dynamic and just dangerous period for a lot of reasons. As you can see here from this little extract from the Vietnam America Friends Association, Tuan gave me these in 2019. He says, I have these documents, and he was holding on to them like this. I'm going to trust you with these. I want these back tomorrow. Which meant that I was up all night with my little iPhone taking pictures of each page. But you know what? It was worth it to get this evidence of the fact that Vietnam didn't have to happen. Never mind the Rand report that was put out before the Vietnam War started that said it was a war that couldn't be won, or at a minimum, a war we shouldn't get involved in. This was proof that the Vietnamese had been trying to do something other than having a war. And this is also with the proof that, yes, Ho Chi Minh was a dyed-in-the-wool communist. He never backed away from that. But such was the nature of the Cold War, we saw things one way as a world of polar opposites. And the reason why I went into all that business last week about those American presidents, Harry Truman, Dwight Eisenhower, John F. Kennedy, Lyndon Johnson, and Richard Nixon, all of them had seen Neville Chamberlain come to power. All of them had seen Neville Chamberlain waving around, or at least had heard about Neville Chamberlain waving around that piece of paper where he said, I have brought peace in our time. He had brought nothing but a delay to disaster. Now, one of those presidents is going to be labeled or risk being labeled in the post-war environment, given the volatility of American politics, as being an appeaser like that guy, Chamberlain. Because you know what happened with him, right? Because he did what he did. Hitler attacked, 50 million people dead that we know of, 6 million in the Holocaust, not to mention the Pacific War. So unless you want to do that again, by all means, be soft on aggressors. Well, none of them were going to do that. And then during the semester, the spring semester, we meet every Monday evening from 6 to 8. We showed them clips from Ken Burns' excellent documentary, The Vietnam War. If you have not watched this, you are doing yourself a disservice. It is simply fantastic. And here's why it's so wonderful. Not only is Ken Burns a fantastic documentarian, but he tells the story of the Vietnam conflict from the American side and the Vietnamese side as well. It may come as a shock. It certainly kind of did to me that I hadn't thought about this, but you know, even the Vietnamese have a point of view. And it needs to be explored. It needs to be explored, not so much to understand them, but to understand ourselves and what we were doing there and why we got involved and why we stayed as long as we did.
I think the Vietnam War drove a stake right into the heart of America. Unfortunately, we've never moved really far away from that. And we never recovered.
There was no way we could avoid telling this story. Wars are so extraordinarily revealing, obviously, of the worst of humanity, but as it turns out, also the best of humanity.
There's been a lot done about this subject. Books, documentaries, feature films, novels. I mean, it's not like no one's ever tried. But it remains this kind of unfinished business in American history.
So it's time now. The decades have passed. And it's important now to go back and try to understand it.
The real heroes are the men that died. To see these kids who had the least to gain, and yet their loyalty to each other, their courage under fire, was just phenomenal. And you would ask yourself, how does America produce young men like this?
We wanted to get to know the people. We wanted to get to know the place. We wanted to spend time there. Trying to figure out how to do what we do in Vietnam was really a challenge.
There's no one American side. And then within Vietnam, there's the winning side. There's the losing side. They were our enemy and our ally. There's just so many different perspectives. We tried to bring them all together.
This is without a doubt the most ambitious project that we have ever undertaken. PBS is the only place it could have been done.
I think the country's ready to have the conversation we've never had about the war, which we really need to have.
This film is not an answer, but a set of questions about what happened.
I told Lee that the story he told last week about his brother-in-law stepping on that punji stick and then having not being able to get rid of that odor, that stuck with me all week. And putting together part two of this and looking at the young faces, and Lee mentioned that his brother-in-law is now 78 years old. I thought, young people who get older, that's just the way things happen, right? I mean, if we're fortunate enough, that's what happened. If God lets you stick around. But what do you do if that's what happens to you and you have to live with that for the rest of your life? I mean, it doesn't go away. And the nation that you did that for is ungrateful to boot. What then? I introduced the students to the fact that, as far as we know, as far as I've been able to figure out, 2,400 Americans did not come home from Vietnam. They are still unaccounted for. 2,400. 2,400. Marines, soldiers, sailors, Coast Guardsmen, whatever, they're still there. You don't see these flags, the POW MIA flags, flying around as much as you used to. But you all remember a time when you sound like every time you go, you could see these everywhere. A lot of them, they were everywhere. And I'll tell them, look, this is obviously fiction, but the message in it is nonetheless true. When he says, you just don't turn it off. Just because they pull you out and you go back to the world, back to the United States, doesn't mean that everything is suddenly better.
It's over, Johnny. It's over.
Nothing is over. Nothing. You just don't turn it off. It wasn't my war. You asked me, I didn't ask you. And I did what I had to do to win, but somebody wouldn't let us win. And I come back to the world, and I see all those maggots at the airport protesting me, spitting, calling me baby killer and all kinds of vile crap. Who are they to protest me, huh? Who are they? Unless they've been me and been there and know what the hell they're yelling about.
It was a bad time for everyone, Rambo. It's all in the past now.
For you! For me, civilian life is nothing. In the field, we had a code of honor. You watch my back, I watch yours. Back here, there's nothing.
You're the last of an elite group. Don't end it like this.
Back there, I can fly a gunship. I can drive a tank. I was in charge of million-dollar equipment. Back here, I can't even hold a job. Fucking cars!
Ah! You just don't turn it off. So after a semester of Monday evenings from 6 to 8, going through the history and with Dr. Vanderstilp covering the culture, and asking questions here and there, trying to prepare them as much intellectually for what they're going to see practically, it's time to get on the airplane. So we go to Detroit. And at the time, because the pandemic was still not a full force, but still very much being observed in many places, we went en masse. Then one of them saw the McDonald's sign. And I forgot how much young people can eat. After one order, the McDonald's manager said, well, we can go home now. We're done for the day. But we got on the plane and flew from Detroit to Incheon, Incheon Airport, which is just near Seoul. And part of their instruction, of course, involves understanding about the Korean War, because Korea preceded Vietnam, as you all well know. And in talking about the Cold War, I said it's very difficult to understand Vietnam while even getting involved in Vietnam, unless you also consider Korea as being that first hot war after World War II, the first hot war for America of the Cold War. And the fact that America did not win that one, which I said established the precedent, you know, we have been fighting wars for to conclude with unconditional surrender since February 1862, when the Confederate commander surrendered to Ulysses S. Grant at Fort Henry and Fort Donelson on the Tennessee and Cumberland River. I mean, the Japanese had surrendered to us on the USS Missouri. How? Unconditional surrender. In other words, look, you started the thing. We won the thing overwhelmingly. Here's the terms and conditions. Unconditional. You are defeated. Well, that's victor's justice. Yes, it is. You know, we get to strike Pearl Harbor, then tell us how to end this thing. Unconditional surrender. But I also explained to them during that spring semester about the danger of Korea, especially the 38th parallel. The 38th parallel is one of the, if not the most heavily and most dangerous borders in the entire world, not in Asia, but in the world. My first commanding officer at Camp Lejeune told me stories about when he was stationed in Korea. He said the North Koreans dig tunnels, not these, you know, great escape tunnels like Steve McQueen in the movie, tunnels that can have 18-wheel tractor trailers driving through them. They do industrial-sized tunnels that went, so that he said, if these guys ever invade, they're going to come above ground and below ground too. He said they have whole highways. So the South Koreans are constantly probing and blowing up tunnels and whatnot to keep these guys. They're constantly probing and they're constantly trying to figure out where there's a weakness. So the South Koreans can't afford to not be vigilant. Now, it's really amazing what happens. Humanity never ceases to amaze me for many reasons. But one of my students went and visited the 38th parallel a few years ago and brought me back a piece of barbed wire. They're selling wire from the border. I said, you know, I shouldn't feel good about this, but I admire their entrepreneurship. Very quickly, about the dangers of the 38th parallel.
I'm standing at one of the most heavily militarized borders in the world, separating two countries that have technically been at war since 1950. This is the DMZ, or Demilitarized Zone, a roughly 150-mile long, 2.5-mile wide buffer zone that has divided North and South Korea for more than 60 years. I'm going to take you inside one of the most tense and dangerous borders in the world, where war could break out at any moment. This is how you enter the Joint Security Area, which is a neutral meeting place inside the DMZ. When the two countries do communicate, it happens in this area, which is overseen by the United Nations Command. Before you can even enter the Joint Security Area, you have to sign this document, which says you're entering a hostile area and may face the possibility of injury or death as a direct result of enemy action. I'm told not to make any hand gestures or point, but over there in the distance, you can see a North Korean guard facing us, and the demarcation line between the two countries is marked by that line of concrete over there. These two blue structures in the middle are where the sides meet for negotiations. Let's actually go inside. The South Korean guard selected here must be tall and have black belts in martial arts. They stand guard in a modified Taekwondo stance, which I learned the hard way when I made a wrong move.
Can you cross over? No, I'm sorry, I can't cross over.
So this is the room where the two sides actually meet for talks. On this side sit South Korean representatives. And over here, I'm technically in North Korea. North Korean representatives sit over here. These microphones on the table are on 24/7, recording everything that's said. And I'm standing at one of the...
I don't know about you all, but I would not even have been technically in North Korea. Now, a few years ago, a North Korean soldier, about 5 years ago, this was caught on video. He made a daring, successful escape. There are people trying to escape North Korea all the time. It's been said that ever since now, North Korea, since the end of World War II, count this, since 1946, 45, North Korea has had three leaders, Kim Il-sung, Kim Jong-il, and Kim Jong-un, three, since 1945. Clearly, dictatorship is the family business. And people are looking to get out, not everybody, obviously.
A harrowing escape from North Korea. A young soldier risking his life, driving across the no man's land of the DMZ, crashing his Jeep, and making a run for it. You can see him there just yards from the border as his fellow soldiers were firing on him. ABC's chief global affairs correspondent Martha Raddatz with a dramatic video of his escape.
It happened near these iconic buildings straddling the border, the only place where soldiers from the north and south come face to face. Those from the north just yards from freedom, a quest that nearly ended in death for this soldier. Behind the wheel of a military Jeep, the 24-year-old barrels towards the south, his fellow North Korean soldiers in hot pursuit.
There's landmines, there are multiple sets of fences, electrified fences, so it's not easy to get across.
The Jeep crashes into a ditch, the border so close, he breaks into a run as North Korean guards open fire, dozens of rounds aimed at the defector, five or six ripping into him as he crosses the dividing line. Critically wounded, these infrared images show what happens next. South Korean soldiers stay low, avoiding fire, crawling towards the defector. That is him lying still. They carry him out, away from the danger, and off to a nearby medical center.
The defector is expected to survive, but he not only has those bullet wounds from which to recover, but he had parasites throughout his body, likely from food and water that were contaminated, which gives you a real window into what life is like for those soldiers.
A harrowing escape from...
So we give the students enough background on Korea, tell them to appreciate that while, even though Seoul is a... Incheon is a layover. Incheon is very close to a battle zone. Very close. And in the Incheon airport, there's this cute little guy, this robot that's going, he just goes back and forth. I don't know what he's saying because he's speaking in Korean, but we decided to take a few pictures with him. And then we arrived at nighttime. Usually we arrive at nighttime at Nobi Airport. And at Nobi, this is where I tell the students, we have told them during that spring semester, that North Korea is divided by the 38th parallel. Vietnam was divided by the 17th parallel. Again, a DMZ demilitarized zone. And this is where we met Tuan in 2022. Now, full disclosure, this is a picture from 2019 when we were there, but Tuan is still Tuan. And Tuan is just amazing. He is the third highest ranking official for the United Nations in Vietnam. He was a child during the Vietnam War. And during the 1972 Christmas bombing, his parents sent him to Russia for safety. Now that requires some reorientation for us because we're used to thinking of Russia as an enemy, as the opposition, the antagonist, not some place where you send your children for safety. But just like Americans ran to Canada for safety to get out of going to the war, to take, his parents wanted to protect him, so they sent him to Russia so he wouldn't be drafted, among other things, into the NVA. Also, Tuan's family, when the communists took over in 1954, I don't know, I can't remember exactly, but I think they were either the second, the third, or fourth most wealthy family in all of Vietnam. They lost everything. The communists gave his grandfather a choice. You can either give me all you have. They lived in a very nice house, which is now a very nice restaurant on a lake in Hanoi, or we can shoot your family. The grandfather apparently had a great gift of gab because he got these communist leaders to spare their lives, but he also got them to agree to send his children to school. Don't want anything to let them go to school because he understood that education, even under the communists, would give them an advantage. Tuan is he's a medical doctor. He's an extremely smart individual. Usually one of the first places that we go to on our first day in Vietnam is the Hanoi Hilton. In the Hanoi Hilton, now these are pictures directly from the Hanoi Hilton. You see pictures of Edward Alvarez, who was the first American fighter pilot shot down, who was housing that facility. They still have his flight suit. They have murals of what life was like, not with the Vietnamese housing American prisoners, but the Vietnamese when the French were in charge of Vietnam as a colonizer. So these are murals of what the French did to Vietnamese fighting against them. Now, before Dinh Binh Phu, 1954, which was called the French Waterloo, when Ho Chi Minh's forces defeated the French at Dinh Binh Phu, which led to them getting out of Vietnam and essentially opened the door for us getting into Vietnam, the Viet Minh already existed. And you can look at this picture and just see what Vietnamese civilians were going through. Inside of the Hanoi Hilton, which is now a museum, there's also a guillotine that they use for beheading people. And there's one display that shows that Bo Nguyen Giap, General Giap, his wife was beheaded by the French. Now, you know, you want to make a lifetime enemy? Here's one method to do it. Cut his wife's head off. You'll guarantee his enmity for the rest of your days. And Vo Nguyen Giap did not spare any effort at all in fighting the French, and then he turned that on the Americans. And by the way, that picture that I showed you all last week, when Allison Thomas is standing in that picture with Ho Chi Minh, Vo Nguyen Giap is in the same picture with them. So Giap was Ho Chi Minh's right-hand man for a number of times. Vo Nguyen Giap was the mastermind behind a lot of Vietnamese victories. But again, it just goes to show, oftentimes these big meta-narratives in history come down to something very, very personal. Vladimir Lenin, of course, was a Marxist, but he fought against the Tsar's regime because they murdered his brother. So it's a brother with his heart broken who says, I'm going to take down the murderous regime. It's not just the Tsar. It's the Tsar and everything that he stands for. You took my family away from me. I'm going to take yours away from you and your kingdom too. Inside of the Hanoi Hilton, they have pictures of John McCain. Now, I thought about this. I said, you know, some of the students, because it was 2022, some of the students remember the 2016 campaign when John McCain's his contribution to the country was questioned. He's not really a hero. And I thought, well, really? Can you be John McCain and go through what he went through and not be at least, if not a hero, at least somebody that, you know, is significant contribution? Naval Academy graduate, son of an admiral, grandson of an admiral, fighter pilot. John McCain flew an A-4 Skyhawk, small fighter bomber. October 10th, 1967, he was taking off of the aircraft carrier for his 23rd mission. Now, he'd already been in Vietnam once, a Yankee Station. That's what they called the area in the South China Sea where American aircraft carriers usually were on their patrol. So he takes off on October 10th, 1967. The target is a Vietnamese power station in Hanoi, meaning above the 17th parallel in Hanoi, the capital city, which because Vietnam was what it was the most heavily armed, heavily defended. So I read some accounts say that Hanoi's air defense systems were more heavily armed, more lethal than anything that the Americans and the British faced in all of World War II. And that was a world war. Now, when the narrator says 16 aircraft the next few minutes, John McCain's aircraft, the kind of aircraft he's flying, will be the last one that takes off before there's some quiet.
F-16 Every 30 seconds, another plane is sent aloft. 16 in quick succession.
That last one that took off, that was John McCain's, the kind of aircraft he flew. John McCain's aircraft was hit with anti-aircraft fire and shot down over Hanoi. Look, you're attacking a power station in the capital city of the enemy country. You shot down, he ejected there, the surface-to-air missile blew the wing off the aircraft, so he can't fly, you need wings to fly. So he ejected. The force of the ejection from the cockpit broke both of his arms and damaged his leg. So he lands in a lake in Hanoi where everyone can see him floating down in the parachute. They didn't get him. They pounced on him, as you can see from this picture, and beat the living tar out of John McCain. Now there's the fear. There has to be the fear that I just tried to bomb my enemy. And now I'm in the middle of their lake. These very unhappy people are coming to get me.
Finally tonight here, honoring an American patriot. We traveled to Vietnam not long ago and visited what's left of the Hanoi Hilton, where McCain was held for 5.5 years. Tonight, our visit just a few months ago to that North Vietnamese prison, now known as the Hanoi Hilton, where John McCain was held prisoner of war. What we found still standing, the rain pouring as we walked through. The prison cells so little light, the bars on the windows, the concrete floors and narrow beds. John McCain was 31 on the day that changed his life. He was flying an A-4 Skyhawk on his 23rd run. He had just dropped a bomb when an enemy missile would tear one of the wings off his bomber. He ejected, and the sheer force of that moment would break both of his arms and one of his legs. The Vietnamese would pull him out of the water and beat him. McCain's father and grandfather were both famous admirals before him. And while being filmed, you hear him being asked his name.
What's your name?
Lieutenant Commander John McCain.
Unable to use his hands, he had to be fed by his captors. The Vietnamese only treating his wounds after they realized who he was.
I see you have a famous name.
Yes.
The Vietnamese would make an offer. They would let him go home, hoping it would be a PR coup, given how famous his family was. But John McCain would refuse, unwilling to break the code. The first man captured must be the first man out. And in what's left of the prison today, we find a book.
You can see here some of the American pilots who were arrested between 1964 and 1973.
The faces of the prisoners from all over the U.S.
To this day, in parts of what's left of the prison here, there are images of the Americans who were captured with captions beneath them that say things like, the Americans enjoying Christmas and receiving letters from family back home.
This one, a photo of American prisoners sharing a prayer. The caption beneath it reads, a Christmas meal.
Okay, so the Vietnamese were not...
Funny tonight.
The Vietnamese were not crazy. They used a... They use their prisoners for propaganda purposes. So yeah, that looks like a very nice meal inside of a prison. It was staged. We drove by this monument. The Vietnamese have erected a monument. Now this is a monument. In the background is the lake where John McCain ejected or fell into the water. The very same lake. There is this monument to John McCain. Not for what, so much what he did that day, but what he became to Vietnam later on. So trying to bring the students up today because, you know, they said, I heard this about John McCain. I said, well, let me put it to you like this. If John McCain's former enemy thinks highly enough of him to erect a monument to his name, what does that mean you should do? But it wasn't just that. John McCain, as a human being, as a man of integrity, as an American patriot, did something which I can't even imagine happening today.
These days, it's hard to imagine a politician praising an opponent. But John McCain did it when the stakes were at their highest. Here's Lee Cowan.
It was an October surprise, unlike most.
I'm concerned about, someone that, cohorts with domestic terrorists such as...
3 weeks before voters would decide the next president of the United States, John McCain, trailing in the polls, told a crowd of supporters Barack Obama was a good man.
I have to tell you, he is a decent person and a person that you do not have to be scared as president of the United States. Now, I just...
Getting booed at your own town hall can't be easy. But John McCain plowed ahead, extolling the differences between debating an opponent and demeaning one.
He's an Arab. He is not...
No, ma'am. He's a decent family man, citizen that I just happen to have disagreements with on fundamental issues, and that's what this campaign is all about.
The morning after, the man who would beat him thanked him.
I appreciated his reminder that we can disagree while still being respectful of each other.
Those few moments before that Minnesota crowd seemed to define what being a maverick really meant to John McCain. He saw the aisle dividing his party from the other as just that, an aisle, not a chasm where common decency is swallowed whole.
Because that's the way politics should be conducted in America.
He turned those boos into cheers. And for a moment anyway, the idea of bipartisanship, of statesmanship, even of friendship in Washington seemed oddly possible.
Then, this is worth hearing. This was a football player for the Arizona Cardinals who spoke at John McCain's eulogy. If you need some, I have some up here because I needed them when I first watched it.
I fell in love with my country when I was a prisoner in someone else's. Senator McCain spoke these heartfelt words as he accepted the Republican nomination for president in 2008. They were the words of an authentic American hero. We all know how the story goes, a fiery Navy pilot shot down by the North Vietnamese over a lake near Hanoi. As his plane spun out of control, he bailed out just in time to plunge into the lake below. That pilot, a young John McCain, was taken hostage as a prisoner of war, where he spent more than 5.5 years, almost 2,000 days, he would endure countless beatings, torture, solitary confinement, and mental and emotional anguish that none of us will ever have to endure. After getting to know Senator McCain, I felt compelled to visit Vietnam. I wanted to see the places where the will of John McCain was tested and forged. I saw the lake. I walked the steps, I sat in the cell, and the ordeal that my friend survived became all the more real. Many people might wonder what a young African-American kid from Minnesota and a highly decorated Vietnam War hero turned United States Senator might have in common. Well, I thought of a few. I'm black, he was white. I'm young. He wasn't so young. He lived with physical limitations brought on by war. I'm a professional athlete. He ran for president. I run out of bounds. He was the epitome of toughness, and I do everything I can to avoid contact. I have flowing locks, and well, he didn't. How does this unlikely pair become friends? I've asked myself the same question. But do you know what the answer is? That's just who he is. Over the several years I had the privilege of spending time with Senator McCain, sometimes it was just a visit to our practices. Other times it was him texting and saying, "Yo, you need to pick it up this Sunday." I'm thankful that through these moments, the opportunity that we had to share our lives, and more importantly, our stories. While from very different worlds, we developed a meaningful friendship. And this highlights the very rare and very special qualities of Senator McCain that I came to deeply admire. He didn't judge individuals based on the color of their skin, their gender, their backgrounds, their political affiliations, or their bank accounts. He evaluated them on the merits of their character and the contents of their hearts. He judged them on the work they put in and the principles they live by. It was this approach to humanity that made Senator John McCain so respected by countless people around the world, including me. His accomplishments were many: U.S. Senator, presidential candidate, statesman, warrior, and hero. His work ethic, tireless. His fight, legendary. But what made Senator McCain so special was that he cared about the substance of my heart, more so than where I came from. While some might find our friendship out of the ordinary, it was a perfect example of what made him an iconic figure of American politics and service to fellow man. He celebrated differences. He embraced humanity, championed what was true and just, and saw people for who they were. Yes, ours was an unlikely friendship, but it's one that I will always cherish. I've had the honor of attending several of the Sedona forums hosted by Senator McCain and his remarkable wife, Cindy. There were world leaders in politics, business, science, and education to discuss the most pressing matters of our time. Issues like healthcare, global warming, technology, and human trafficking. These leaders gathered to find real solutions, and they gathered because Senator McCain asked them to be there. I fell in love with my.
So the student said to me, "So does this mean that John McCain was a hero?" I said, "Yeah, I think so. A different kind of American hero. One that I say, yes, he was, and I miss him." After the Hanoi Hilton, we visit what we call the pagoda. This guy right here, Tuan refers to him as the most venerable monk. You see that look of serenity on his face? That guy has that look all the time. I wonder, every time I visit him, I say, what do you know that I need to know? Because he runs this, I don't know if it's a monastery, it's a hospital, but in Vietnam, there are a lot of AIDS patients or people who are HIV positive, and they're dealing with AIDS, the HIV or the AIDS crisis there now, the way we did with it in the 1980s. I remember in the 1980s when this first hit the United States, that even at my company at the time, the aircraft company where I was working, you know, there are all the rumors about you can get it from shaking hands with somebody, being in the same room coughing with somebody. There's two ways: sexually transmitted or use of needles. So two things: be careful who you lie out with, or don't share needles. But what he does in this facility is that people who are suffering with HIV or who are HIV positive, they're sometimes very often disowned by their family. So they will come here. They'll come here, and what they'll do, the most venerable monk, which is simply give them time, space, and love. I've asked several times, what medicines do you use? They don't use any. Just straight up human compassion. Like this lady, she's spoken to the students each time. And these people, they are so calm. They're so gentle. You have to ask yourself, again, what are you doing? What do you know that I need to know? They take the microphone, they pass it around. They speak very openly about what they have and what their lives are like. Some of them who are disowned by their families or lost spouses, they found lifetime partners among the group of them there. And again, it's just the simple act of kindness. Now, whatever physical or physiologic effect love and compassion can have on people, it apparently is working there. Because many of them have said that they were diagnosed and not live, you know, 6 months a year. Some of them have been around 5, 10, 15 years. So there they are. Simple kindness and love. One of the students on the last trip in 2022 was a smoker. He's looking for a pack of Vietnamese cigarettes to buy. He says, Professor Johnson, I just want to try one. I said, well, I don't smoke, so I don't think you should either, but it's your body. So the Vietnamese are not subtle about what smoking will do to you. And he bought this package. It's not like, you know, the little smoking is harmful to your health on the side that you have to turn over and look at it. They have pictures of people like this guy coughing up a lung. You have other people, you know, laying there. And he's still lit up. I said, you are a work of wonder to see that picture and still light the cigarette. I said, that means me not want to smoke, and I don't smoke. After the first few days in Vietnam, we turned north and went to a place called Hai Giang. And when you're riding on Vietnamese roads, you will see a lot of things. And I got to tell you, actually seeing water buffalo walking along a Vietnamese road, it is still much more comforting than seeing orange barrels that go on forever. Did you notice that there is a last buffalo? So this will end. Now, this is from 2017. We first went up there in 2017. And look at the young lady on the far right in the white blouse. Now, at the time, in 2017, they had just started something. These are three Hmong women. Now, the Hmong live in the northern part of Vietnam, in the highlands. Vietnam, I think it's the Cham people, which is the largest ethnic minority, and the Hmong are like maybe the second or third largest minority, but they're one of the Vietnamese minorities. And I think that even in the United States, the largest Hmong community is in Minnesota. But these three, what Tuan was telling us, that what they noticed was that there was a high infant mortality rate and also a lot of mothers dying during childbirth. Now, apparently in Hmong culture, men are not allowed to be anywhere in the area when women are giving childbirth. And so male doctors, which are majority in Vietnam, are not allowed to be anywhere near a woman when she's giving, when she's delivering. So the question was, well, what can we do about this? Well, Tuan got together with some female doctors, and what they did was they trained midwives. These three women are midwives. So they're not medical doctors, but these women will help women with prenatal care, childbirth, postnatal care. And so the child mortality rate went up, or sorry, survivability rate went up, and also with the mothers as well. Now, in 2017, Tuan said that the program had been cut. I said, how much is it annually? He said, $100,000 annually. I said, you know, now that's a lot of money to me, but for the American foreign policy budget, that is nothing. So they cut it. In 2022, the young lady on the far right in the white blouse, that's her in 2022. So the budget was cut so that, at least in 2022, she's the only midwife that's still working in that area. And believe me, she runs that thing. She's in charge. This is one of the mothers that she helped. Now, when I first saw her, I said, wow, what, is she carrying her mother's child? No, that's her child. So it's some, you know, you just have to imagine the looks on my students' faces when they're seeing these children who had children. These are their peers. Here they are, 18, 19, 20 years old. Some of these people have three or four kids by then. Not to mention, Tuan and the midwife said that they have a diet that's very low in protein. So the kids are usually small, as she is small, and they have also an effect, because they have a low diet in protein, high in starch, that is corn, so their cognitive development is stunted as well. So small size, impact on cognition. And one house that we visited, the woman allowed us to visit her anyway, and I think they said that the week before, or maybe just a few days before, her baby had died during childbirth. And she still opened her home up to us. It felt embarrassing to be imposing upon her at that moment. But, you know, when you're in a different country and people invite you into their home, it's always a toss-up. Do you say yes, say no? So we went. Tuan thought it was okay, so we went. And there's the whole group of us. And I got to tell you, this is one of the better pictures, because usually when we take a group shot, especially in Haizong, now the reason why we can get to the Haizong to get to this facility is because Tuan, being the third highest ranking UN member inside of Vietnam, he pulled some strings to get us up there, because it's right along this area. This is close to the Vietnamese-Chinese border. And this is where we found out in 2017 that the Chinese policy, the one-child policy, they favor male children. It's coming back to visit them in a very big, unpleasant way. 30 years of favoring one child, favoring male children, there's not enough women in China right now. So what they're doing is, sometimes the Chinese army is coming across the border to kidnap Hmong women to be wives. And also in this picture, every now and then we take a picture in Haizong, you'll see some people who are not part of the group. Well, who are those guys? Well, it's just best not to ask who these guys are. It's not an area that very many Westerners get into, and they're there to make sure. Look, I tell the students several times during the trip, look, Vietnam's great. We have a lot of good time, beautiful people, beautiful country, but it's a communist dictatorship. Don't forget that. Going back south, no, I guess we're just in our Buddha mood. We stopped to get some stuff on the way back south to Hanoi. And then we took an in-country flight to Da Nang. Now, Da Nang was that place where when the American troop buildup began, Da Nang was the major staging area. It's where most of the supplies, most of the troops came into Vietnam through Da Nang. And at one time, it had a 500,000 people. And MACV was there, Military Assistance Command, Vietnam. And it was there in Da Nang where we took off and set up to the countryside to go to what was called the children who were still suffering from, but not still suffering, but children who now with the fourth, fifth generation are still dealing with the effects of Agent Orange, the defoliant, the contaminant. Now, it was called Agent Orange because the chemical came in 55-gallon drums. They had an orange stripe on them, or colored orange. So they didn't give it a name, so they called it Agent Orange. Operation Ranch Hand ran for a number of years, which is what it's called. A defoliant, so that the American way of war, which involved airstrikes and artillery missions. Artillery missions usually require, or usually have, for the best artillery missions, something called an FO, forward observer. Now, the forward observer will be on the ground, usually deployed. You say you have an artillery battalion, one guy from the artillery battery where the guns are, so he knows how they operate over there. They'll assign him to be with the infantry battalion over here, because when you do a call for fire, he knows their language. So the infantry guy infantry officer can do a call for fire, but the artillery guy, he's one of them. So he talks to them in their language. Same thing for an FO in an airplane. Now, during the Vietnam War, there was something called the OV-10 Bronco, where the FO, the forward observer, would be in the sky and looking from the air, of course, would get the grid coordinates. It's a four-digit grid coordinate, 6-digit coordinate, 8-digit coordinate, or 10-digit, the more numbers, the more accurate the round's gonna fall. But it's very difficult to see. We had triple canopy jungle. So the way to see your target is to get rid of the jungle. Get rid of the second and third layers of canopy. Now, the first, second, third layers of canopy are ecological. That's how Vietnam has evolved as a country, and the wildlife and the land and the rivers and all that goes with it. When you chemically destroy the land, you upset the ecosystem as well, not to mention harming the people. But no one's thinking about that. At least not very many people are thinking about it during the Vietnam War.
Other vital components of the airborne war are such specialized tasks as defoliation, a maneuver designed to peel back the cover from which the Viet Cong spring ambushes on Allied supply convoys and troop movements.
In 2017, we visited an archaeological site that happened to be just in the jungle where there was triple canopy coverage. I mean to tell you what, it was sweltering beneath three layers of leaves. And I tried to imagine myself, okay, I know what it's like to carry a full combat load as a Marine, but to be doing that in that environment where the temperature is already high and humidity is just there, and then there's no sunlight coming down, and so the heat reflects up from the earth, then back down. You have your pack on, your weapon, your two canteens. If you're an M60 gunner, a machine gun, ammo boxes, all this stuff like that. What must it have been like for these soldiers, these Marines, fighting in this environment? And every now and then, people are trying to kill you too. No one told the men flying these aircraft, especially the ones who are in trace that is behind.
Other vital components of the airborne war.
The second and third aircraft, they're flying right into the mist. So the air crews are getting it too. And the men on the ground that handled the 55-gallon drums that loaded the stuff on the helicopters, they got exposed too. This is why Lee's story stuck with me, because there are things that were done during the Vietnam War to fight the war that impacted American service women and men, just like they did the Vietnamese. So we go to the Vietnamese center, one center where the children are there during the daytime. They're getting educated, they're learning a skill, they're teaching them different things they can do to make a living. Some of these kids, or maybe these adults, because some of them are 35 years old, they just don't look it. That's the impact that the chemicals had on them. And our students are there. We have many education students. And after a while, you can just see that it's a natural love affair. After they get introduced and explain who we are and what the students are there for and some of the things they do, they spend about maybe an hour to 2 hours just having a good time with each other. And you know, when you see this going on, this is how you know that Hope College students are some really spectacular people. Because they just love on these kids as much as they can. I never did ask even what they were looking at, but. And then later on, I was still in Da Nang. We go to visit Mr. Le. Mr. Le survived the My Lai massacre. Mr. Le saw his mother killed by a US soldier. I don't know if it's 50 yards or 50 feet, but it's 50 something yards or feet away from him. He said that the morning that the Americans came there, they came in three waves. And if you've seen the movie Platoon, you recall the scene where they just go on that rampage when, you know, one of their own has been killed. And the thing about Vietnam was that, again, to refer back to what Lee said last week, it wasn't so much that it was a war, you know, where there's these big firefights. That happened, of course. But very often, people who will be killed by a landmine or a punchy stick, some passive aggressive kind of thing that'll kill you just as much. So it's not direct contact. And so what happens is that you're out there in the bush, you're scared, you're young, you're hot, you're tired, you're grumpy, you want to be back home, and you're losing friends of yours. Because when you're out there with each other like that every day, you become friends, you become family, you become brothers. And people start getting taken out one at a time, and they're there, and they're dying, and you can't see how they're dying. Attacks from above and below, there's nothing to shoot at, nothing to take your aggression on. That begins to build up. It's not to explain it away, just to help you understand why young men will go over the edge. And at that moment, that day arrived in the area of Song Mai, that it happened to one of theirs, a number of theirs. Punji sticks, different devices, traps. And it didn't help that they had bad leadership under Lieutenant William Calley. Mr. Love says that his mother that morning sensed something wrong, more so wrong than the usual wrong. They were in a country that was at war. So she told him when the American soldiers landed in the area nearby, the Huey helicopters came and sat down. She told him to go run and hide in some brush, and he did. And from that location, he watched them as they assaulted his home and killed his mother. Now, Mr. Lu, on two occasions, I don't know how Tuan found this guy, but Mr. Lu, in 2019 and in 2022, he invited us into his home. He sent his neighbors to go get us cold drinks, very hot days. You see the table there with all the bottles of water and the bananas, the fruits. He fed us. He's opened his house up to us. And in 2019 and in 2022, I confessed to the students. I said, look, I'm trying every day to be a better Christian, but I'm not so sure that if somebody murdered my mother and I saw that, I don't know if I could rise to this level of hospitality even now. I might get there, but not the way he's doing it. We simply just invited all of us in. Now, in 2019, Mr. Love explained very matter-of-factly what happened to his mother. In 2022, he broke down in tears. And nobody needs to ask why. I mean, he's been through something that's traumatic. He'll never get past that. And he probably shouldn't. But Mr. Lu signed a copy of his book. He's written a book. He gave us all a signed copy. And in 2019, one of our students who visited the My Lai Museum, I walked over to Jamie and I said, what are you doing? She was just staring off in the distance, looking at some of the different exhibits. And she just started crying. I said, what is wrong? She went, I have been K through 12 in most of my college career. No one's ever mentioned this to me. It was the first time she'd ever heard of the My Lai massacre. She said, how can we do this? I said, how can we do what? She said, we're supposed to be the good guys. I said, Jamie, we are the good guys most of the time. I said, that's why we went through all that instruction about the Cold War and the Korean War. And the fact that foreign policy was decided in terms of this or that, either or, you know, very simplistic decision-making based on the most recent disaster, World War II. People's judgment, was it what it should have been? Because the information they had on hand wasn't as complete as it should have been. And then they were motivated by other things as well. This is called the complexity of history and human existence. Never mind history, it's just life. What's better to have more information than less? Why we should do war less than more, all those things, all the above. But still, how come I haven't heard about this? That's why we're here. So as you can imagine, at this part of the trip, the energy level comes down appropriately to reflect on what Mr. Love's been through. But because we are aware of the fact that there are very big highs and very deep lows in a trip like this, we take them to Hoi An, which is a resort where their leadership has trouble being mature. And we stay there all afternoon. This is one of the more interesting things that happened. I mean, the whole trip was just interesting. I've been to Vietnam three times now, and I have two people said to me, well, is it different each time? I say, yes, it's life-changing each time. This was the war of my generation, the war that I grew up with. Didn't fight in it, the war that I grew up with, my father, my uncles. So it's the war that kind of shaped me. It's kind of the war that helped me understand what war was as I went to the military myself. It's one of the last gatekeepers. But we back in Da Nang, we stopped at this place. I think this is the lower level of what Tuan's house was that his family used to own. And it was a hot day, and we wanted to do something nice with the students, so we got him some ice cream in a hollowed-out coconut shell. Now, we came out. We come out of this ice cream shop, and there's cars going by, horns blowing, everything. And above all that racket, I hear, hey, brother, brother, brother. What? Who's? I said, well, because, you know, I said, there's not a whole lot of black people in Vietnam. So who's calling a brother? Just because you call a brother, why should I? You know, I said, he could be calling anybody. Well, it was this guy. Now, I think he's about maybe, what, 6'3", 6'4". So he's extremely, say, big, dark-skinned guy walking down the street with two big garbage bags. And I thought, who is this guy? He went, brother, brother, brother. He said, man, I'm so glad to see. He said, I've been in this country for 3 months. You're the first one. I said to him, you know, you're making this really difficult right now. So his name is Rutindo Hidengwe. He's from South Africa. He's a businessman. He was in Vietnam on vacation. We instantly, within seconds, we were like that. He's just the most engaging, outgoing. You look at his smile. You can't help but like this guy. So we took a picture together. And while we were standing there, people are walking by, and Rutindo does this. He says, hey, are you Vietnamese people? If you find that you're missing something, we got it. I said, not funny, man. But Rutindo wrote we have been in contact with each other. We're talking about doing something together, presentation internationally. He wrote a book entitled Rumble in the Jungle, Reloaded. Like I said, he's from South Africa. He goes all over the continent. He's trying to draw European business, American business to say, look, you know, we have a young population, got lots of natural potential, lots of resources. Come to Africa and do business. One of the last places we go to on the trip is Cu Chi. Now, for those of you that are aware of Vietnam, don't know about this part of Vietnam, they were called tunnel rats. American soldiers and Marines who are usually about maybe 5'5", 5'6", the shortest guys, will be sent headfirst into these tunnels where the Vietnamese had entire military complexes. Let me put it to you like this. We have been shown tunnels that were able to withstand bombs dropped by B-52s. That is B-52s that have a max ceiling of 40,000 feet. Now, a 500-pound bomb dropped, let's be generous, at 28,000 feet. A 500-pound bomb at 28,000 feet making a direct strike on a tunnel like that should blow it to bits. They survived. That's how well built these things were. Again, this is why I thought about Lee, because the Vietnamese used these, and while they were doing while they were down there below in these below the surface tunnel networks, they were doing things like designing punji sticks and developing traps. And again, like Lee pointed out, very often they would take a punji stick and dip it in buffalo, water buffalo manure, or some other poison. You just leave it sitting there so that when you step, and if you've never seen a boot from the Vietnam War, they're very, very light, not like the kind that the soldiers have today, not the kind that were in World War II, very light boots that had kind of like a mesh on the side because of the jungle to let the feet breathe. Because infantrymen will tell you that the only thing they love more than food is dry socks. trench foot, socks. A new pair of socks in the bush can make your day so bright. So a light boot like that, and you step on a punchy stick, which is made out of bamboo, the hard, one of the hardest but lightest woods in the world. You sharpen it to a point, you step on it, especially if it's been put down 6 or 7 inches into, you're gonna go down. So your weight is gonna push down, push up in to the bottom of the, and it's gonna sever your Achilles tendon. That's called you being out of the war for a while and having a severe limp for the rest of your life. Because they understand our code is we don't leave anybody behind. Leave no man behind. So one gets wounded, it's a fire team of four. One gets wounded, three pick him up and carry him. That's four people out like that. When you're a third world nation, fighting a nation that's got aircraft carriers and bombs and missiles and whatnot, you use cow manure and bamboo. This Vietnamese, now the panel on the left shows you how today, this shows you how they went underground. It's a more formal entrance, of course. The first time in 2017, I went underneath and crawled through some of those tunnels. I will not do that again. And the Vietnamese say that even now, it's difficult for them to go through. They say, you have to understand that during the war, we had a very poor diet. We were a lot smaller than we are now. So their diet is better. So now they had trouble getting through the tunnels too. Now, Eric, all the students tried to go through one, but just to give you an idea how well these things were made. So this is Eric. Eric's about maybe 6'2". He gets down on this thing. He lifts up the little door, the ceiling, drops down in it. If you're that combat Marine on patrol and you're walking past and someone pops up and shoots you from behind and then goes go back down, when you tell the people that they just seem to come from anywhere, they're invisible, this is why. Also, the Vietnamese took truck tires or tires and would trace the pattern of a foot and would make sandals out of the discarded tires. And then what they would do sometimes, they would take the tire. I still can't explain how they did this, but what they would do is they would take the tire and make the sandal and then reverse it so that they would put it on. They would walk it this way. But what you think, as they're going this way, they're actually going that way. So if you're tracking them, every indicator is they're going that way when in fact they're going that way. So here you are, you're tracking them this way when they actually went that way. Then plus the spider hole. If you're interested in reading about this, the tunnels of Cu Chi, which talks about the men who fought below ground. And I hope it's obviously apparent to you that any person that goes headfirst into a tunnel like this, they have a flashlight and a 45. If they have some emotional or mental issues afterward, they're supposed to. And then this one, tunnel rats. General Douglas MacArthur was invited to give an address to West Point's alma mater. MacArthur was somebody that you either loved him or hate him, but he loved the United States. And during that speech, he said, the shadows are lengthening for me. He was coming to the end of his life and he knew this, but he wanted to give those cadets a final word of what they were doing at West Point. With their charge was of the latest generation to graduate in the long gray line. I told my students that what happens as people begin to get deeper into their journey is that you begin to run out of mileage in front of you, so you look at the mileage that you travel behind you. That's all that's left. So General MacArthur was doing that. And I think that what he said to those cadets at West Point applies to the veterans of Vietnam, their wives, the women who fought in the war, the nurses who were there. Is it all we're getting ready for that last LZ, that last landing zone?
Participation or military solution. Your guidepost stands out like a tenfold beacon in the night. Duty, honor, country. You are the leaven which binds together the entire fabric of our national system of defense. From your ranks come the great captains who hold the nation's destiny in their hands the moment the war tocsin sounds. A long gray line has never failed us. Were you to do so, a million ghosts in olive drab, in brown khaki, in blue and gray would rise from their white crosses, thundering those magic words, duty, honor, country. This does not mean that you are warmongers. On the contrary, the soldier, above all of the people, prays for peace, for he must suffer and bear the deepest wounds and scars of war. But always in our ears ring the ominous words of Plato, that wisest of all philosophers. Only the dead have seen the end of war. The shadows are lengthening for me. The twilight is here. My days of old have vanished. Tone and tint, they have gone glimmering through the dreams of things that were. Their memory is one of wondrous beauty, watered by tears and coaxed and caressed by the smiles of yesterday. I listen vainly, but with a thirsty ear, for the witching melody of faint bugles blowing reveille, of far drums beating the long roll. In my dreams, I hear again the crash of guns, the rattle of musketry, the strange, mournful mutter of the battlefield. But in the evening of my memory, always I come back to West Point. Always there echoes and re-echo duty, honor, country. Today marks my final roll call with you. But I want you to know that when I cross the river, my last conscious thoughts will be of the Corps and the Corps and the Corps. I bid you farewell.
This last one is called Vietnam Reflections. And the reason why I thought about Lee's story from last week, all week, is because it reminded me of some of the veterans I see standing at 131 and Wealthy when I get off the highway. And they're holding that sign that says, Vietnam veteran, anything will help. And I like to think, I imagine for myself that they got one last LZ, one of the last landings on the land end. At some point, like during MacArthur, they're cross into that LZ. And just like this guy in the reflection, he's still on this side, but his friends are waiting for him. And whatever he's suffering with right now, once he joins them, he'll be 19 again. Whatever he was left with from the Vietnam War, he might even prefer to be with them in a state of constantly watching that LZ or on that fire base, because he's with his friends again. When he felt the vastness and all the energy of life was there, it's wartime. Nothing glorious about it, but not abandoned, not looked down upon by society. With friends that understand him, and he understood them, and they're all involved in one common thing together, watching each other's back. But until then, they'll wait for him at the wall, at the Iwo Jima Memorial. They'll be like that B-52 pilot we met over there who went back after he got back to the United States and his marriage fell apart. He thought about what he had been doing, dropping bombs on Hanoi in 1972 during Operations Linebacker 1 and 2. And psychologically, he just could not deal with the fact that he had been bombing civilians and children like that. So the marriage fell apart, he started drinking, marriage fell apart. Kids would have had nothing to do with him. So he moved to Vietnam. He's been there for the last 50 years, doing what? Going around the country, looking for unexploded bombs, helping them get rid of them. That's how he spends his days, undoing or defusing the bombs he dropped. Vietnam did something to us. I'm not so sure that we have fully figured out what it did, but whatever it was, we can't afford to forget it. Thank you. What are your questions or your comments, please?
I think we have one in the chat, David. Is there one?
Yes.
I served during the Vietnam era. I knew about the tunnels. I never knew about the conical rooms amplifying the sounds of bombers. Did you study that at all?
The conical rooms amplifying the sounds of bombers?
Yeah.
You know.
On your drawing.
No, I did not.
I had no idea about that.
No.
Awesome.
What I did find out, they had turned the Coochie, the region around Coochie, we found out was that a 300-mile tunnel network, if you can believe that, 300 miles of tunnels between villages. So the Viet Cong could move from one village to the next below ground and you'd never know they were there. It was incredible. But again, if you're fighting, if you're a third world nation fighting a first world superpower, not just a first world nation, but a first world superpower that's armed with nuclear weapons, that's what you do.
Yes, you've talked a lot about how, well, you shared the example of how one student cried when she learned about the My Lai massacre,
mm-hmm.
and other ways that you just said, you finished, I'll just say this. You finished by saying Vietnam changes, but we don't really know how. What I was wondering, as you were going through the presentation, which was excellent, how did you see your students change as a result of going on this trip to Vietnam? Does that make sense?
Yes, it does. I think, you know, most of them have heard about Vietnam kind of like as a distant thing that happened. They've been told, like, you know, Vietnam was a hard war. It changed America. But, okay, it's a statement of the obvious. Once you're on the ground, they're seeing the actual destruction, seeing what happened. And then we had Tuan with us. Now, Tuan, usually when we get to Da Nang, there's one part when we're at Da Nang where we give Tuan an evening. And he explains to the students what his family went through during the 1972 Christmas bombing. His family was in Hanoi at that time. He talks about how entire sections of Hanoi were bombed out, what his parents had to go through to keep them safe. And you can see there, the gears turning, like, here's Tuan, who's a very friendly guy. You know, he's very effective. He calls my cherished students. They love him. I mean, really, they just love him. Tuan's hard to not love. So they're trying to square how this guy as a kid was flinging American bombs. And again, they're not saying, you know, bad America. They're just trying to figure out, how does all this work? You know, how could we have been so angry and bomb people like you, Tuan? Well, the Vietnam War had atrocities on both sides. It was a war. And one thing about Operation Linebacker 1 and 2 was that one American foreign policy official said that it was Richard Nixon having a temper tantrum using B-52s. Other people will say, well, Linebacker 1 and 2 is what brought the Vietnamese back to the negotiating table in Paris. They had gotten up, walked out. Nixon said, okay, you want to do that? We're going to do this. He sent the B-52s. But on the ground, there were people. On the ground, there were U.S. soldiers. So they're trying to put all that together. And so what it does is it helps them stop thinking so simplistically about U.S. history, U.S. foreign policy. And I can begin to system them that they're connecting the dots between what happened back then, what's happening right now, and how what's happening even in Ukraine and Russia, how these things have global implications because we leave a global footprint with the United States. And they're more mindful. They say things like, you know, I'm going to pay more attention to current events or look deeper into this. So I can't say for the long term, but it definitely has an impact on them. Some of whom have said that if they can go back a second time, they will. Rick? Oh, sorry.
Yeah. Hi, Fred. Jerry? I was a college graduate in 1967, early 1968, I was drafted. Thought I would get a good assignment. They put me in the infantry, sent me to Vietnam. I was in those triple canopy jungles.
You're Marine Corps too, right?
I was Army.
Army.
I was diagnosed a couple of years back with PTSD.
Mm-hmm.
So I go to group. And it's interesting, the long-term effects of us Vietnam infantry veterans as to what Vietnam has done. You never forget about it. You think about it daily. And like MacArthur said, when you're across the line, you can meet other Vietnam vets and have that discussion.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think the effects of Agent Orange from the other vets that I talk to, and I volunteer at the VA in Wyoming.
Yeah.
Cancer, heart disease, Parkinsonism.
Yeah.
It's all there, and it's kind of like that T-shirt you can buy that says, I'm a Vietnam vet suffering from what I incurred 50 years mm-hmm. ago.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. The first off, thank you for that. And yeah, the as far as I know, if anybody knows something different, please let me know. But as far as I know, the U.S. government still has not taken responsibility fully for Agent Orange. The Vietnamese are still looking for, you know, some type of restitution or even an acknowledgement. They're like, well, you know, we recognize something bad happened, but it wasn't us. Well, okay. The Vietnamese don't see it that way. So that battle continues. And even more to the point where people inside of Vietnam has said to me, look at your own soldiers. They were affected by it. They handled the stuff. If they're affected, you know what it did to us, right? So, well, that's for the diplomats to work out. But the evidence, when you see those kids, and I know somebody who recently died from complications from Agent Orange. It's just real hard to, at some point, you can say it's anecdotal, but you know, so many anecdotes add up to something. So yeah, Rick, your question.
Yeah, well, I'm going to just make a comment because I think, Fred, you've done a tremendous job. And I want to point out to the community here and to the gentleman over here in the Army and to Lee, I have a phone call to make. It doesn't have to do with Vietnam directly, but September 18th, we've got a phone call set at 6 o'clock. And 17 guys are going to be on the phone. And 60 years before, we raised our hand in the Navy ROTC at the University of Wisconsin. Mm-hmm. And all of us graduated. We started out with many more. But we didn't even talk to each other for 40 years. But the camaraderie today, you've got to understand, it's completely different than a friendship here. It's a situation of where you call some people. I made a point of going up to Minneapolis twice. I've had dinner with friends up there.
Yeah.
We have a dinner and we have a luncheon in Temecula, California.
Yeah.
It's a friendship situation you don't understand unless you've been through it. And now we're not just best buddies necessarily. Some of us disagree on things, but then we get riled up, and I'm not going to talk Republican, Democrat or that type of thing. But when you get people in Congress who say, well, I don't want to fund the military, excuse me, I'm tired. No, we've got the military has a need and a place. And Fred, you've done a fantastic Thank job you. Of explaining the purpose of it. Thank you for being here, Fred.
Thank you. You know, one of the most amazing stories I've heard about the military, and this comes from that. I was at Baylor about maybe 3 years ago for a conference with the Institute for Faith and Learning. And I decided, well, I'm in Texas. If you're in Texas, you got to eat the steak. So I went to the Texas, the Longhouse, or one of those steakhouses. And standing in line, now this is in Waco, right? So it's not Dallas, it's Waco. So I'm in line. And there was this guy in front of me, he had on the leather biker's jacket, you know, the chaps, you know, ponytail down here, bald up here, a ponytail. He's going, okay. And it says, you know, kill them all, like God sort of. I'm like, wow, okay, that's kind of radical. But then, you see, he looked at me and kind of sneered. I looked at him, he looked at me and went, I looked at him and went, And then I saw the eagle go up an anchor on his forearm. I said, you Marine Corps? He went, yeah. I said, who are you with? He said, I was with the Walking Dead, 3rd Marines. He said, who are you with? I said, I was 1st Battalion, 8th Marines. The 5th Battalion, 10th Marines. You know, when Marines start talking about Marine Corps, I was with El Mako, or I was with this group, or FSSG. That's how you knew you're talking to one of your own. And you know what? The fact that it was Waco, Texas, I'm Black, he's white, he may or may not be a biker. I'm a guy in town attending with, you know, all that stuff went away. I said, if this country could do what the Marine Corps has done, and that one thing, simplify, we said, simplify. He went, simplify, Marine. I said, simplify, Marine. We had a real good conversation. All that other stuff, where we were, our background just went away. Only thing that mattered at that moment, we had gone through the Marine Corps. That's we shared a common identity as United States Marines. And likewise, United States Marines, United States Army, United States Navy, Air Force. If you're part of that brotherhood, sisterhood of the U.S. military, you've earned your right into that fraternity, where, as the thing said, for those who had to fight for and die for it, freedom has a taste that the protected will never know. Thanks a lot, you guys.
Thank you.